Good morning, students. In this video, I shall discuss the respiration in human being. How does this respiration process occur in case of human being? Now, this respiration, normally we shall study here in three important headings. First, we shall study the respiratory system or the organs which are involved in the process of respiration, particularly breathing. And now, how the air enters into the lungs, the pathway through which the air actually enters into the lungs, we shall discuss in detail. Then next, we shall study the mechanism of breathing, how this breathing occurs, how the air enters into the lungs and how the air comes out of the lungs. Now, this process is called mechanism of breathing, and it normally completes in two phases, the inspiration and expiration, inhalation or exhalation, that means the taking in of air into the lung and giving out the air from the lung. Now, we shall study first the respiratory system, or you can say that is the breathing system as well. Now, what is the important organs which are involved in this process? The first, this is the nose, it is the external outgrowth, consists of the cartilages, but there is the opening through which air enters into the nasal passage, that is called the nostril. It is, this opening is in the downward direction, that is why it is an advantageous, because the air which are present here, normally the particles which are present there due to the gravitational pull, the particles goes down. So that is why fresh air enters here. Now next is the nasal passage. And this nasal passage, it is normally partitioned by a thin cartilaginous membrane, and they united together here, and that is called the pharynx. Now in this area, you will find some hairs which are present. And these hairs, normally, it prevents the entry of the small particles, like the dust particles and other particles which are there along with the air. Then the mucous membrane is there and the mucous cells are there. That is why this mucus is secreted here. And this mucus normally sticks some particles. If some particles are there in the air, then these particles are stick to the mucus. And the fresh air enters here through the pharynx. After the pharynx, that is called the larynx or the voice box. This larynx or voice box, which is present here, and when the air comes out, normally due to the vibration of the vocal cord in the larynx, there is the vocal cord. And due to the vibration of this vocal cord, normally the sound is produced. And the sound is now modulated by the tongue, and the speech is now produced there. So that is why the role of the larynx, it is not actually passage of the air, but it helps in the production of the sound. That is why it is called voice box. This larynx is also called the voice box, and where the voice or the sound is produced. Now, next important part, that is the trachea, and which is also called the windpipe, through which the air passes to the thoracic cavity. And this windpipe is open always because it has the ring of cartilages. This is called a ring of cartilages. Our cartilaginous rings are there, and these cartilaginous rings, it does not allow the trachea to collapse. Trachea never collapses, it always open due to presence of these cartilaginous rings. These are semicircular in nature from the external side, and normally in the inner side, it is normally addressed to the oesophagus. Now, the trachea here, when it enters into the thoracic cavity, and this is the bronchus. Two bronchus normally form an dioxide and this bronchus again divided into several branches to form the number of bronchioles. And now the bronchiole lastly, finally, they divide and redivide to form the alveoli. And this alveoli is the smaller sac-like structure where actually the exchange of the gases occur. And this structure, this is called the lungs. There are two lungs present on either side. This is the spongy area and it normally gives the surface area for the exchange of the gases. And it is, its surface area is very large, around 80 square meter of surface area actually present there folded in folded condition inside the lungs. Now, this cavity inside which the lungs is present, that is the thoracic cavity or chest cavity. And this thoracic cavity is separated from the abdominal cavity. This is the abdominal cavity and this abdominal cavity is present in the lower side and this abdominal cavity is separated by the diaphragm. So that is why this diaphragm plays an important role in increasing and decreasing the size of the thoracic cavity and accordingly the inspiration and expiration occurs. We shall discuss in detail about it during the mechanism of breathing. Now, this lungs which is spongy, delicate and elastic. The spongy and it is very much delicate and elastic in nature. And the membrane is thin. So that is why the exchange of gases is very much suitable here. Now, the lungs is covered by a covering that is called the pleura. And the cavity is called the pleural cavity. Inside the thoracic cavity, the lungs is present inside the pleural cavity. Now, these are the important organs which are involved in the process of respiration or external respiration, you can say, that is the breathing. And these organs directly involved in this process. Now, what is the pathway of the air which actually enters into the lungs finally for the exchange of gases into the blood? Now, the pathway starts from the nasal opening that is called the nostril. The nostril is present from the nostril. The air enters into the nasal passage and in the nasal passage the hair is there, the mucus is there which normally prevents the entry of the smaller minute particles which are present along with the air. Then the next chamber that is the pharynx which is just above the vocal cavity and from the pharynx then to the voice box or the larynx, then to the trachea and from the trachea it passes to the bronchus which normally these are the bronchus and this bronchus again divide and redivide to form the large number of bronchioles and these bronchioles finally they enter into the small sac-like structure. There are millions of sac-like structures which are present there in the lung and these are called the alveoli and here actually the exchange of the gases of these are very thin and delicate part and where the exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide occurs with the blood because the blood circulation is well connected to the lungs. So that is why here the exchange of the oxygen and carbon dioxide occurs. Now the next important is the lungs. It is the larger part. Both side two lungs are there and these are the surface area for the exchange of gases and this is spongy and elastic in nature and the large surface area is there that becomes around 80 square meter of surface area. It is available for the exchange of gases. Now we shall discuss the mechanism of breathing in case of human being. Now this mechanism or inspiration and expiration or inhalation and exhalation or you can say intake of air into the lungs and normally giving out of air from the lungs. This process is called breathing. Normally breathing, one breathing completes by two phases. The first phase intake or inspiration and the second phase it is giving out or expiration. Then how does this inspiration and expiration in case of human being occur. Now, as we know, this breathing process, it is actually an involuntary process. Involuntary means it is going on automatically. So that is why whenever we are sleeping, then also the breathing process is going on. So that is why it is an involuntary process. Then if it is an involuntary process, now we are not actually taking the oxygen or giving out the oxygen, but it is going on automatically. Then how does it occur? Now, this autonomic nervous system actually gives the signal for this. Now, most important thing is that the position of diaphragm. Actually, this diaphragm plays a vital role because it is the muscular membrane which is present in between the thoracic cavity and the abdominal cavity. And it actually increases or decreases the size of the thoracic cavity by going up, there is a dome circuit diaphragm, and going down. So when it goes down, normally the cavity becomes larger. And when it goes off, then the cavity becomes smaller. So that is why during inspiration, this is the normal position. But when this diaphragm becomes straight, in this case, the inspiration occurs. And when it goes off, it is expiration occurs. Now, how it occurs and what are the important role played by the muscles present there? Now, during this inspiration, what happened? The first, when you look at here, what are the different steps which normally involved in this process? Now, the first, that is the contraction of intercostal muscles. The intercostal muscles which are present between the ribs or in the ribs, normally they contract. Due to this contraction of the intercostal muscle, normally the size of the diaphragm becomes straight. Or the diaphragm, second important event which occur, now the diaphragm, it becomes straight. And when this diaphragm becomes straight, this rib cage, this is the rib cage, and this rib cage normally moves upward, and the rib cage, it normally moves forward and upward. So when it moves forward and upward, automatically the volume of the thoracic cavity increases. The volume of thoracic cavity increases. So when the volume of thoracic cavity increases, automatically the volume of the lungs will also increase, because the volume of the lungs, it is flexible because it is elastic in nature. So that is why the next event is the volume of lungs increases. So when the volume of lungs increases, automatically what will happen to the air pressure? Air remaining constant. If no air is going out or coming in, that means air remaining constant, then the pressure of air in the lungs automatically decreases. Because the volume increases, so that is why the air pressure decreases. So when the air pressure decreases in comparison to the atmospheric pressure, because it is directly connected through the nostril to the outside, so that is why in the atmospheric pressure, that is 76 mm of mercury. And if the air pressure is normally decreased here, as per the normal principle, the air always blows from high pressure to low pressure. So when the low pressure is created here inside the lungs, then
automatically as per the normal property of the air, air will rush in. So automatically the air will rush in. So that is why when the air pressure decreases in the lung in comparison to the atmosphere and it is directly connected to the atmosphere, then automatically air rushes in to the lung. So this process or this phenomenon is called inspiration. So this is the first phase by which the inspiration occurs or intake of the air occurs, but it is actually going on automatically. But what is actually we are doing here, we just straight the diaphragm and increase the thoracic volume, automatically the pressure decreases and air enters in. Now the next phase, that is called expiration. And what happens during expiration? During expiration, what happens? The position of the diaphragm goes back to its normal position, or that is the dome shaft position. So how it happens? It is due to the relaxation of this. Now the first event here during expiration, that is the relaxation of intercostal muscles. The intercostal muscles which are present in between the ribs, normally they relax, and when the muscles relax, automatically the diaphragm returns back to the dome shaft. It returns back to the dome shaft, and when it returns back, now diaphragm, it becomes dome shaft, or it is, you can say, curved. When it is curved, then what will happen to the volume of the thoracic cavity? Now the next important event, that is the volume of thoracic cavity decreases. So when the volume of the thoracic cavity decreases, automatically as the lungs is spongy in nature, the volume of the lungs also decreases. So when the volume of thoracic cavity decreases, then automatically the volume of lungs also decreases. Now when the volume of the lungs will decrease, this is the lungs here, and if the volume will decrease, then what about the air pressure present inside it? Air remaining constant, the air pressure, if the volume decreases, automatically the air pressure in the lungs automatically increases. So when the air pressure will increase, then what will happen? The atmospheric pressure is now low. The atmospheric pressure is low and here the pressure is high. So automatically air will come out. So that is why air now rushes out. So this phenomenon or this process is called expiration. So that is why one inspiration is followed by one expiration. So that is why one inspiration and one expiration, that is one breathing. So one breathing includes one inspiration and another one inspiration and one expiration. And one inspiration always followed by one expiration. So that is why it is a rhythmic process. It is the rhythmic process. So that is why one inspiration and one expiration, it completes one breathing. Now what is the normal breathing rate in case of human being. The normal breathing rate, the rate of breathing. The rate of breathing is normally 12 to 18 times per minute. And when the air enters into the lungs, what about the air? Because the oxygen is actually taken by our blood. But when it is coming into the lungs, normally the air, whole air actually enters. So the atmospheric air, normally, what about the position of oxygen and carbon dioxide? In the atmospheric air or normal air, it contains around 21% of oxygen and 0.034% of oxygen, carbon dioxide. So that is why this air or atmospheric air, it is called the oxygen rich air. But when it comes out, normally the exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide occurs. So oxygen normally enters into the blood circulation and carbon dioxide coming out from the blood. So that is why when the carbon dioxide coming out of the blood, so the air which is coming out from the lungs, it contains more carbon dioxide and less oxygen. But here it contains more oxygen and less carbon dioxide. So that is why this air which enters into the lung, it is called oxygen rich air. And the air which is coming out, that is the carbon dioxide rich air. So this air normally comes out. Now, when exchange of the gases occurs there in the lungs, and when they enter into the lungs, always a normal air entering into the lungs and air coming out of the lung, but there some amount of air remain inside the lung. This is called the residual volume. So this residual volume, that means inside the lungs, here, inside the lungs, some amount of air always remains there. Suppose these are the lungs, and some amount of air remains here as the residual volume. So it gives certain time for the exchange of the gases with the blood circulation. So this residual volume always remains inside the lung, and it normally gives time for exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide. So that is why this residual volume, it plays a role and gives the time for exchange of gases. So that is why always this breathing is going on just like your heartbeat. Heartbeat is going on continuously, starting from the birth till the death. Like that, the breathing is also going on continuously, starting from the birth till the death. But, of course, the rate of breathing may vary time to time. Sometimes when we perform our exercise, when we are in frightened condition or excited condition, the breathing rate may be faster. But the breathing going on continuously, and it is a rhythmic process just like your heartbeat. Contraction, relaxation of the intercostal muscles occur, and due to this contraction and relaxation of the intercostal muscles, normally the volume of the thoracic cavity increases and decreases due to the movement of the diaphragm. So movement of the diaphragm is normally done by the intercostal muscles, and it is rhythmic and controlled by autonomic nervous system. So that is why it is an autonomic process or involuntary process. Now, this volume of air which enters and leaves, it is continuous, and breathing rate, as we already discussed, that is 12 to 18 times, but it may increase to many folds during exercise, and that is why more amount of air enters here. Now, when it enters here, next important event, the oxygen is taken by the hemoglobin molecules or hemoglobin pigment. which are present inside the RBC of blood. And now this oxyhemoglobin complex, when oxygen combined with the hemoglobin, then they call the HbO2. And this HbO2 is also called the oxyhemoglobin complex. Now it transports the oxygen to each and every cell of the body. And when it enters into the cell, then it helps in breaking the food. Suppose food is there, like your glucose molecule, and this oxygen breaks to release the energy. Now, sometimes what happens? If sufficient hemoglobin is not there, now hemoglobin is 22, normally 16 gram percentage or a gram per cubic deciliter of blood. But sometimes if less amount of oxygen is, less amount of hemoglobin is there in the blood, then anemia occurs. And due to this anemia or anemic condition, the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood becomes lower, and sometimes they suffocate, and lack of oxygen causes problem for the human beings. Now when this oxygen actually transported to each and every part of the body, then only the energy is released, and without energy no human being can survive. So that is why if we do not take food for even 7 days or 8 days or 1 month, you cannot die, or you will not die. But if you will not breathe or intake or take oxygen for 2 to 3 minutes, then you cannot survive, because we cannot store oxygen inside our body. So that is why you must have to take the oxygen continuously from the atmosphere. Now, sometimes what happens if the oxygen content becomes very low in the atmosphere, or sometimes what happens when carbon monoxide molecule, which is one of the constituent of the atmosphere, sometimes if carbon monoxide is present more amount in the atmosphere, then what happens? The oxygen molecule is less there. The hemoglobin, which will bind to carbon monoxide, and that is called carboxyhemoglobin complex, and they form the carboxyhemoglobin. And this carboxyhemoglobin, it is a complex which is formed when more carbon monoxide is there, and that is why the oxygen carrying capacity of the hemoglobin will decrease, and automatically this complex causes the poisoning or oxygen starvation, you can say. That is called carbon monoxide poisoning. And due to this carbon monoxide poisoning, sometimes the death of human being may occur. So that is why the affinity of this hemoglobin to carbon monoxide is more in comparison to oxygen. So that is why it causes problem, and that is why it causes the death of the organism. That is called carbon monoxide poisoning. So this type of problem sometimes occurs, and there are so many other problems also occurs in the breathing system. But I hope this is for the day, and this video will definitely be useful for you. And if it is really useful for you, then please like it and subscribe for further videos. Thank you. Thank you very much.